next on Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, Mariah Carey. She became the best-selling female artist of all time and encountered fame beyond her wildest expectations.
Now that the paparazzi has, like, you know, invaded my privacy and taken pictures of me in my pajamas, been in every tabloid, you know, supposedly been to 99 fat farms and had 35 breakdowns, it's like, okay, now I guess I'm famous.
And when her fairy tale marriage ended in a highly publicized divorce, Mariah took a beating for trying to be herself.
I think she missed out, like, on a lot of things that 18-year-olds and 20-year-olds get to do, like going to parties and showing a little cleavage every now and then. If you got a cute body, you want to show it off.
She wants to be naked in a video, she's going to be naked. It's her world, she's going to be doing whatever she wants to do.
Finally on her own, Mariah then pushed herself to unbearable limits in order to prove that she was worthy of her success.
I had this work ethic that I imposed upon myself that was really harsh. It was like, do another album, do another album, do another album, one for every single year.
But a lot of the critics didn't want to give her credit. She was a girl that they loved to hate at that time. I think that's very unfair.
Now, the making of a megastar and her metamorphosis through self-expression, strength, and a never-ending quest for ultimate independence. This is Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, Mariah Carey. Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, hosted by Meredith Vieira.
Anyone who's ever been in the public eye, myself included, knows that the press can distort the truth. Take Mariah Carey. Sure, it sells more papers to portray Mariah as a drama queen than a hard-working professional. But as you're about to discover, becoming the best-selling female artist of her time has taken as much sweat and determination as a great set of vocal cords. So forget everything you've read or heard and meet the real Mariah Carey. This is her story, her words.
By 2001, 30-year-old Mariah Carey had unequivocally established herself as the best-selling female artist of the rock era. With more weeks at the top of the charts than Madonna or even the Beatles. But there was one part of her audience she had yet to win over, the press.
I've had an awareness about the press and the way things have been written about me from the beginning, because I always felt like there was kind of a level of people who didn't quite get me. And for the, like, cynical rock critic, of course they're not gonna like me. Why are you even going to my show? Just so you can slay me in the review?
That's the machine that this industry had created for us. You know, and if anybody's outside the box, then, you know, they get harassed.
I think the things that people say are very hurtful, and I think they do affect her to some degree. But she's a fighter, and she's gonna fight through whatever you have to say or whatever you think.
But Mariah's resilience would be tested that year. She had just signed a $100 million deal with Virgin Records, for whom she was both making her feature film debut and recording an album. As if that weren't enough, Mariah was flying back and forth between movie sets, also testing the waters in the indie world.
And if that wasn't enough, she was trying to edit the movie, mix the album. I mean, that's phenomenal. A lot of people can't mix all those things together and still come out okay.
Mariah wasn't okay. In July 2001, she was admitted to a hospital for exhaustion, and the media descended upon her, desperate to prove that the girl with the Midas touch was finally down for the count. Rumors circulated that she was suicidal and had suffered a nervous breakdown.
To me, when you say, like, nervous breakdown, or you getting sick or something, it's like you start going crazy maybe and twiddling your lips and just, and start screaming at people. It wasn't like that. It was just time for a break.
Me being the person I am, I never usually say no and make boundaries. I just got exhausted and I really just collapsed because it was too much.
Unfortunately for Mariah, things would get worse before they got better. And in order to move forward, she would be forced to both reevaluate her priorities and return to her roots. Mariah Carey, born on March 27, 1970, was the youngest child of opera singer Patricia and engineer Alfred Carey. The baby of the family wasted no time letting everyone know what she wanted to do with her life.
I have one memory when I was like, I don't know, 3 or 4 or whatever, and so we're at the dinner table, and I started singing. My father was like, there's no singing at the dinner table. So I got up from the table, and my brother and sister were like in shock, and I stood on the coffee table in the living room and started singing. I don't know what song it was. I was like, if I can't sing at the table, I might as well sing on the table in the next room. So I guess that was like a clue.
It was around this time that Mariah's parents divorced. Her older sister, Allison, moved in with her father, while Mariah and her brother, Morgan, remained with their mother. Mariah's mother soon saw that her daughter possessed more than a childlike interest in music.
She tells this story that she was doing Rigoletto, and I heard her singing over and over this one part, and then one time she did it differently, and I corrected her in Italian and sang it to her, and she said she like stopped in her tracks like, huh? You know, how does this little girl, you know what I just said in Italian? And that's when she was like, okay, she has a very good ear. Let me, you know, make sure I nurture this.
Patricia Carey encouraged her daughter and helped her to realize she had a special gift. However, living in Long Island, Mariah was finding it difficult to come to terms with another aspect of her identity, her interracial heritage.
One of my earliest memories is being in kindergarten and they asked you to draw a picture of your family. And so I drew my family and, you know, how we looked. And then I drew my father and I was using the brown crayon. And I suddenly heard these two people behind me, these two like young kindergarten teachers like snickering and laughing. And I was like, you know, really sensitive always. So I was like, what, you know? And they were like, you're using the wrong crayon. Why are you making your father that color? And I was like, no, that's what my father looks like.
When you're mixed, it's hard because sometimes when you're around, like, for example, white people, and you're either very light, they may say something like derogatory about the other race that you are of, and then vice versa. So a lot of times it's hard to be neutral.
My mother's family, for the most part, disowned her when she married my father. So that, the understanding of that also made me feel like, what does that say about us, the children of this union? Like, what does that say about me? Does that mean that, like, I'm an unworthy human being?
As a way of expressing these feelings, Mariah began writing poetry, which very quickly turned to songs.
I started writing songs, like, around 8th grade. It was like my release, and it still is. So I guess that's where the beginning of the songwriting started.
Her music speaks to a very specific part of everyone. It's the underdog in all of us. You know, the person that didn't get the love, the person who's missing the love, or the person who needs the encouragement or the strength to pull through and to make it.
Then when I got to be like 13 or 14, I was doing some demos for people around where I lived. They would like be trying to sell jingles or whatever, and I had like a commercial voice to them.
By the time she got to high school, Mariah had firmly set her sights on a career in music and was spending most of her time in recording studios and precious little of it in class.
I would sign into school late every day. I mean, don't try this at home, people. But I would basically, you know, be working in the studio till like 3 in the morning and then come back, and you're not gonna get up at 7 and go to school. So I would breeze in like 5th period and with my forged note and be on my merry way.
After graduation, Mariah moved to Manhattan and devoted herself full time to her career. She worked odd jobs waitressing and pounded the pavement with her demo until a job as a backup singer for Brenda K. Starr, famous for her hit I Still Believe, changed everything.
She really took me under her wing and was always listening to my demo and trying to get other people to listen to my demo. And at one point was like, I want to bring you to this party. And I was like, okay.
The party was for WTG Records, run by music industry bigwigs Jerry Greenberg, Walter Yetnikoff, and Tommy Mottola.
Brenda was like, you know, bringing me over to meet Jerry Greenberg. So she says to Jerry, this is my friend Mariah. She writes all her songs, goes to hand him the tape, and Tommy Mottola was standing next to him, takes the tape out of his hand, grabs it, and puts it in his pocket. And I was like, confused because I didn't know who any of these people were, but I was like, that guy's not going to listen to this tape.
Mariah was mistaken. Tommy Mottola listened to the tape that same night on his way home from the party and returned to find Mariah, but she'd already left. She had no way of knowing that destiny was knocking on her door.
It was like this strange moment in time when everything just happened. I got a message from him on my machine, and it was just like, yeah, Tommy Mottola, Sony, whatever it was at the time, CBS, call me back, bye.
Next, Mariah's phone call leads to a date with fate.
In all honesty, I never really believed in marriage because I never saw an example of one that really worked.
And later, she is forced to choose between the public and the press.
Nobody is everybody's favorite. That's an unrealistic goal.
When Lifetime's intimate portrait, Mariah Carey, continues.